What kind of decoys do I use? How about motion devices? Today is part two of my end of season gear review, and it's all about decoys. I'm Joel Strickland, and this is Surviving Duck Season. Thanks for watching Surviving Duck Season, where we feed your waterfowl obsession and help you to maximize your hunting experience. And on today's video, I'm talking about decoys. I'll give you my insight into what I've used and what I like best. Now, in my arsenal this year, I've used several different brands, but the majority have been tangle-free, lifetime decoys, Decoys, and GHG. The way that I use decoys, we keep them in slotted decoy bags. We take good care of them. We don't leave them out, you know, maybe overnight occasionally, but for the most part, they get brought in after every single hunt. Let's talk about tangle-free decoys. About 5 or 6 years ago, Scott bought, I don't know, probably 30 or 40 dozen duck decoys from tangle-free. We bought them because the way they look, the head positions and the way that the decoys look themselves looks really good. The paint scheme looks really good and natural. And so that's the reason why we got them. What I don't like about them is they tend to look dingy very quickly. Even though, you know, there may be some dirt on them and you wash them off, they do look a little bit better. But it seems to me like in my experience of using all the different brands of decoys over the years, those look pretty dingy quick. I'll move on to lifetime decoys. Last year, I got a couple of dozen lifetime mallard decoys from the company. They provided them to me to do an honest review. If you haven't seen that video, make sure you check it out. I used those decoys throughout the entire rest of the duck season last year, so it was about 30 days or something like that. And then I have used them throughout the duck season this year. Just about every day I use them, as well as mixing in, you know, some of the other brands of decoys. My opinion of them is just pretty much like I had at the end of duck season last year, you know, in January of 2020. This is an example of their decoy right here. It looks pretty much brand new. You can't tell the difference in this decoy and a brand new decoy. That's one thing about the lifetime decoys that I'm extremely impressed with. They hold their color very, very well. They perform very well in the water. They move around really good. Because I like their decoys so much, I actually bought some of their new Widgeon decoys to add to my spread. One thing that I don't like about the decoys is that when you do get them muddy, you really have to clean them. You can't just hose them off like you can a regular hard plastic decoy. You've got to get, and you got to get a scrub brush and brush it off. Because of the foam material they're made of, it just sticks to it. But that's my only negative. Great decoys. Now let's talk about greenhead gear decoys. Now, I've had some of them over the years, and I've really never had a great opinion of them. But in December, I saw some of their flocked ones in Max and thought, man, these look great. We got several flock decoys from GHG. Scott bought a bunch to use for himself. I bought some for me. I bought a six pack of the pintails because I just thought they looked so fantastic. I mean, looking at them when they're brand new, just out of the box, they look like a mounted pintail. I mean, they look that good. This particular decoy, as well as a hen in the kind of the skimmer position, I decided to use for a motion decoy device called Duck's Track. I'll talk more about that product a little bit later, but needless to say, this decoy does not look near as good as it did when I first, you know, first got it. And obviously, you know, with wear and tear on decoys, that happens. But this decoy was babied. I'm talking, I babied these decoys. I was very careful with them because they're flocked. I didn't want them to get ginked up. But literally within about 2 or 3 hunts, they already look like this. Now they're very faded looking. Now when you dunk them in the water, it kind of darkens them up for a little bit. But as soon as they dry, they look back like this again. And so, you know, you can see the black on it is starting to come off. Some of the edges has come off. Is right here. It's just generally overall faded. This is one of the better looking decoys than some of the other ones that we've got. I don't think we had any where the flocking peeled off, but it just looked like somebody took sandpaper to the decoys. What about the fully flocked Dakota decoys? We got some mallard decoys that look absolutely atrocious. I mean, it looked like somebody did not take care of their decoys and beat them around, and they look like that halfway into the season. I like the painted Dakotas, but the flocked, no. If you are a guy that hunts more than about 8 or 10 times a year and you want some flocked decoys, I would consider going a different direction than the GHG or Dakotas. And while we're talking about decoys, we can't forget about rigging. I use Texas rigs for all of my decoys, and you've probably seen some of my videos where I'm talking about that. So what do you know about Texas rigs?
Texas rigs? I know about Texas rigs. No problem.
Over the years, I've made a lot of my own rigs, but I've also bought and used many of the pre-made rigs. There's a lot of bad ones and some good ones too. In particular, I don't really like the Cherokee Sports or the GHG rigs. Those are really the worst ones I've used, and I'm not at all a fan of the monofilament rigs. They definitely do not last as long as coated cable. Now, Tangle Free calls theirs the Easy Rig, and I like that one pretty well. The cable is a little bit stiff, but it's still a good rig. I also like Rig'em-Rite's rigs and these from Lifetime Decoys. What I really like about the Lifetime Decoy rigs, the cable is very light and bendy and has no memory. This is also one of their DIY rigs that I made myself. I actually like this one better just simply because I made a bigger loop right here. It's easier for me to hold and, you know, toss the decoys out. Okay, let's talk about motion devices. Spinners, agitators, ripplers, squirters. Let's first start off with the duck butt type devices, and there's a lot of them. And I'll go into the ones that I have the most experience with. First, we'll talk about the Mojo Flyway Feeder. This device looks really good. It squirts a lot of water up. It doesn't have a ton of, you know, this kind of motion, but it does have some, and it looks really good. Next is the Lucky Duck Agitator. It definitely gets a lot of good motion this way, squirts a lot of water. But the problem with both of these two different devices is that really after just a very short time, just a very few uses, the amount of water that is thrust, you know, through the device seems to be considerably less. It doesn't get near the motion, doesn't get near the squirt, even after just, like I say, 3 or 4 uses. I've even, you know, taken it apart, looked into the pump on all the ones that I've used, and I've had several of them. They all do the same thing. Now, a similar product is the Higdon Pulsator. These things are great. I mean, they have a lot of volume of water that squirts out. They do a lot of motion. They seem to be very, very durable. I've got one that I've had for about 3 years. I've got another one that I've had now 2 full duck seasons, and they do very well. Now, this is one right here, and it's a pintail, obviously a pintail version of it. You do have to take care of them, you know, just like anything. You got to take care of them. I recommend keeping it in a hard plastic case, because this part of the decoy is very fragile. You don't want to be grabbing and picking it up like this. You want to pick it up with this part of it, or this part of it right here. This part of the decoy tends to bust, like this one has right here. I have fixed it. I put some 5200 on it. I've used zip straps to hold it together. It's probably going to have to be replaced. These things kind of tend to break different points, and you just have to replace them. That they sell these replacement parts so you can do that. I've also used some of the Wonder Duck products over the years. This one has little feet that make it more of a splasher, as well as this one. It's a duck butt variety. These are really good to use in extremely shallow water, but they're not necessarily my favorite if I have enough depth to use a pulsator or this next device. This is made by the people that make the Ducks Track. This is a dipper tail, is what they call this, and I started using that this year. As far as the amount of movement and the ripples that you get on the water, this product is definitely the best of all of them as far as that goes. But, you know, there's always a trade-off, you know, with anything. The trade-off with this product is you have to have enough depth in order to use it. And unfortunately for me, a lot of times I'm hunting in water that's this deep. It's hard enough to get like a pulsator or something like that to work, but this is never going to work, you know, in that shallow of water. So you either have to take a little shovel and dig it out, or something like that. The other dilemma that I have is we hunt a lot of fields, rice fields and moist soil habitat, where there's lots of vegetation. And when you're hunting in shallow water and you have vegetation, it makes it even more difficult to use this product with a lot of success, because the way this thing works, you can see right here, it spins around, and you can already see I've got a little bit of, you know, grass that's left over from a hunt that I tried to use it on. It just doesn't always work when you have a lot of vegetation. Now, you get this thing in, you know, more than knee-deep water, you don't have much vegetation, this thing goes like a champ. It's just the nature of what you got. You know, every product doesn't work every single place that you use it. And that's what you have to remember with some products like this one. They work extremely well in a lot of places, but not everywhere. Spinning wing decoys, do they work? Well, yes and no. It depends on where you hunt and when you hunt as to the effectiveness that you're going to have with them. I've done quite a bit of hunting, you know, early season and in the northern states. They work really, really well when you're in those types of situations. They will practically land on them. As you get later in the season and further south, the success is different. We use them more as an attention getter than we are as a finishing device. You're not going to use spinners as a finishing device most of the time, you know, where we hunt in Arkansas, but they definitely work as an attractor, particularly on sunny days. Now, this year, what's been my success with them? A lot less than normal, and here's the reason I feel like. We dealt with a lot of stale birds in Arkansas this year. We did not get very many pushes of birds. I feel like that we had the same birds throughout the entire season. We had a pretty good push of birds early before duck season, and then we had a decent little push of birds toward the beginning of December, and that may have been the majority of our migration that we had. And so when you have stale birds, when you have birds that have been around for a while, there's a lot of things that don't work very well on them, and spinning wing decoys is one of them, unfortunately. I use a jerk rig pretty much every day, unless the wind is blowing pretty strong and we've got a lot of movement. For the most part, we have a lot of cover, we hunt in timber, we have a lot of stubble sticking up, so it tends to block a lot of the wind from the decoys many times. And so that's why I'm using motion devices and nearly always using a jerk cord. There's a couple of products that I always keep in my blind bag all the time. I wanted to kind of show you guys. This is 80 Below. It's synthetic sporting oil that you can use on guns and really just about anything that's mechanical that needs lubricating. You can use it on fishing reels or, you know, squeaky doors or whatever. But this stuff is absolutely awesome. They also make it in an aerosol can. I also keep things like a face mask, of course, hot hands. This is the body warmers. These things are incredible. They last 18 hours. I'm sure most of y'all have probably used those before. Of course, headlamp, good pair of binoculars. I use them all the time for scouting, but also for looking for cripple birds and things like that a long way away, so I can handle my dog. These are Leicas, incredible optics. I've had them things for 20 years. All right, here's another thing that I like to use just about every day. These are Atlas gloves. These things go all the way up past my elbows. I prefer using the uninsulated ones. That's what these are. And the reason is I'm not going to be wearing them for very long, because I'm only going to use them for just a few minutes when putting on decoys and that sort of thing. And so the reason why I like the uninsulated ones is because they're thinner and I'm able to feel things, you know, with my hands. I have better dexterity. But like I said, I use them for putting out decoys, but even more so, putting out some of my other contraptions that I use, like the Ducks Track. The Ducks Track device is a product that I'm very excited about. I got a couple of them back at the beginning of duck season and started using them, and very much impressed with them. They're not something that you can use everywhere, at least not for me. We have a lot of situations where we're hunting in water that's this deep, and it's barely deep enough to submerge this particular product. As you can see, the little wheels have to be submerged in order for it to be able to use the product. And a lot of times it's just barely under the water for the places that we hunt. My experience is sometimes it works in those situations and sometimes it doesn't. It's really dependent about how much level the bottom is. If you've got a little bit of a rise here and there, you're going to have to take your foot and mash down the mud to get it to where you can get that device completely under the water. I found myself on many situations where I'm hunting in water that's this deep, I just simply was not able to get the product to work. Now, that's not the majority of the people that are watching this video probably don't have that problem. And so if you can get it, you know, this deep or waist deep or, you know, over your head, you can use that product definitely. Another drawback is if you have a lot of vegetation, you've got to do something to get the vegetation out of the way. I had the problem several times where I was having to pull, you know, stubble and stuff like that, mash it down and get it out of the way after the device had been running for 5 minutes and all of a sudden it quit working. And then I found that there was stubble kind of wrapped around, you know, some of the wheels. And so that's something that you have to be aware of. Again, every single different type of product doesn't work 100% of the time in every type of environment. This one definitely has a lot more strengths than it does weaknesses. I've provided a link to this product and others that I featured on this video in the description section, so make sure you check them out if you're interested in any of the products. And if you want to support my channel, please consider buying a Surviving Duck Season t-shirt or some of the other merchandise. You can find it on our website, survivingduckseason.com. So that's my thoughts on decoys and decoy-related devices and parts. If you missed my video on part one, where I cover calls, firearms, ammo, and other things, make sure you check that one out. And if you missed this video, make sure you watch that one too. I'm Joel Strickland. God bless, and I'll see you on the next video.